Ladies and gentlemen, are you ready? Please welcome.com. Are you ready to be blessed? Are you ready to experience the magic of praise and worship? Or are you ready to experience the magic?
The power of God through Evangelist Rock. The power of God through Evangelist Rock.
Seven, six, five, four, three, two, one, zero.
Thank you, everybody, for showing up here at Consuming Fire Radio. I'm telling you, I'm glad to have everybody here this evening, and it is a blessing to be with you all, and I'm getting ready to play another selection. First, before we start, folks, I want to give shouts out to Apostle Arthur Timberlake, and also Minister Robin Lynn that are out here listening. I thank you so much for supporting Consuming Fire Radio and everybody else that is tuned in here this evening. And I thank you for that in Jesus' name. And I give God all the honor for this broadcast and other broadcasts coming to you through Consuming Fire Radio. I thank you so much, folks. God bless. Bye-bye. We'll be with you in just a minute.
You loved me through my good. You loved me through my bad. You loved me through my good. And you loved me through my bad, Jesus. You didn't erase my future because of my past. I'm glad you loved me through my good and my bad. Through my good and my bad. You loved me through my good. You loved me through my bad. Didn't erase my future. Hallelujah. Because of my past. Thank you. I'm glad you loved me through my good and my bad.
You loved me through my good and my bad.
So glad. can't you love me?
You love me through my good.
Never took your love away.
You love me through my bad. Yeah. You didn't erase my future.
Thank God you didn't write me off. I even did some things I know you despise, God.
You love me through my good.
And my bad, yeah.
You love me through my good. Through my bad.
God, I know sometimes we make you ashamed.
You love me through my good.
Thank you for never giving us what we deserve.
You love me through my bad.
After falling bad. Again and again. Every blessing and request that you granted, Lord.
Because of my bad.
Could have withheld, but mercy intervened.
You love me through my good.
Through the rebellion.
You love me through my good.
Through all of my shortcomings.
You love me through my good.
And this is my favorite right here. You keep on loving me. Can somebody help me? You keep on,
keep on
loving me.
Loving.
You keep on,
keep on
loving me. You keep right on loving me. Through the good and the bad, you never stop loving me. Through the lessons learned, you show me. We disobey, we run away from you. Bring shame to your name, but your love remains. Who can love me like you do, Lord? What you are to me, no man could ever be. You see through every mistake, through every stumble, you prove to your children you'll always be there. Through every slip, through all of my issues, you could have been finished, you could have been gone, but you put up with me. Kept on teaching me, kept on. All my good and my bad. You love me through my good and through my bad. Oh, didn't erase my future because of my past. I'm glad you love me through my good and bad.
Amen and amen. You know, he's loved us through our good and our bad. I tell you, that is so true by Jay Morris. You know, Lord Jesus Christ, he loves us through our good and bad, but we have to repent of our sins and come into him. I'm telling you, that's what it's all about, folks, is repenting of your sins. There's a lot on my heart that I'm going to share this evening with you folks. But right now, our final selection of music, it's been played. It's one of my favorites, as well as Apostle Arthur Timberlake and others. And I'm going to play it again. This is God's Got It by Jay Morris.
Yeah.
Amen. God's got it, man. I tell you, he's got it if you believe in the scriptures and you believe in him. I'm telling you, this is so important at this day and hour, folks, that we're in. Do you really believe God's got it? Do you really believe that you have your salvation? Do you really believe what you're standing on is true? Now, come on. We have got to check this out. We're going to check this out here this evening on the broadcast of Consuming Fire Radio. And I tell you, it's so nice to be back with you folks. And we have our phone lines that are open. We're going to give that phone line out here in just a minute. Computer's coming up here with it. The phone number is 559-726-1300. You can call in. We'll be taking callers later on. You can call in and listen. The access code is 195379#, and you can get right in there. It is open for the callers to call in or just listen, whatever you want to do. We're going to get right into the broadcast of what God has brought upon my heart. It's not going to be long, folks, but it's going to be thorough and right to the point what God has got for us. God's got it. I can tell you, God's got it if there's a condition, if you truly believe what he is saying in his scriptures. You truly believe what he is telling the people over there. Do you really believe it? Or are you just going to church? Are you caught up in Christendom doing your everyday thing when you go to the church? Are you out doing, being a doer of God's word? We're going to find out here. We're going to find out not what Evangelist Mike Bradford has to say, but we're going to find out what God has to say through his scriptures. You know, and we're going to start out with prayer. If you would, please bow your heads with me. We're going to go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Father God, we just ask right now in the name of Jesus that the Holy Ghost would go forth and prepare the hearts of the people for this word that is going to be brought out, that it'll be, Father God, a word that'll penetrate into their spirit. It'll get them checking out to see if they're really truly being your disciple, if they're really meeting the criterias of what you said here in your scriptures, Father God, about being a disciple of Christ, what it's going to take to be your disciple. And if they're not doing it, we just ask, Father God, that they would repent. The Holy Ghost would convict them and they would repent of their sins and start doing what you've called them to do. Folks, we're going to go right into Luke chapter 9. I tell you, the whole Word of God is just awesome. It speaks to your heart. It reprograms your sinful nature into God nature. It turns things over by getting into the Word and having daily relationship. But Luke 9 is where Jesus and his disciples, they just got done feeding the 5,000 up on the hill, and with two loaves and five fish, or, you know, and they were out there and they did that. That was a miracle. That was a pure miracle that was performed, feeding all those people. And when they were coming down the hill, they were, going to their next destination. One of the disciples asked him a question. You know, it was like, you know, what do we have to do to follow you, dear Lord? And over here in Luke chapter 9, starting with verse 23, and we're going to go with verse 23 to start out with, and it said, "And he," that is Jesus, "said to them," the disciples, "if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me." Now, in the Strong Concordance, I went in there and I looked up that word deny. And that means to forget oneself, lose sight of oneself, and one's own interest. Hello, I'll say that again. This is out of the Strong's Concordance. It says, I'll go back to the scriptures and where it says, and I'll read it again, Luke 9:23. "And he said," which was Jesus talking to his disciples, "and he said unto them, if any man shall come after me, let him deny himself." And I took that word deny, looked it up in the Strong's Concordance, and it says to forget oneself, lose sight of oneself and one's own interest. Hello? What do we think today is going in the body of Christ? Right there, it has a lot to say. And we're gonna go back and we're going to pick this out here. And he goes on to say, it means, and take up his cross daily and follow me. Now, I went in here and I looked up the word cross, and it means figuratively to extinguish, subdue, passion, or selflessness. That means you're still denying yourself, you're taking up your daily problems, and you're carrying them along with Jesus, because he has got it. As Jay Morris said in the song, God's got it. But the thing is, in Christendom, and I'm using that figuratively, that means the whole body of Christ. Today, there is another gospel that is being preached in this emergent church movement and other movements that are going around. Paul talked about it. It was happening in Paul's time. The Word of God says nothing's new under the sun. You know, it's time's repeating itself time after time after time. Nothing's new here upon this earth. It's the same old same thing. It just goes in cycles. And right now we're back in that cycle here in this end times that we are in, as it says in Matthew 24, which I'm not going to touch on. But I just thought I would refer that scriptures for you to look at. And it says, deny himself. How many of you denied yourself, or did the preacher evangelist tell you that you had to deny yourself? Did he say that you just repeat after me prayer? Did he say, just ask Jesus into your heart and everything will be okay? No, Jesus is saying to his disciples here, meaning you and I as well, because we, when we became born again, we're supposed to be his disciples, aren't we? Come on, folks, let's connect the dots here. This is what it's about, denying oneself. That means getting out and doing things for others. And the cross that we're supposed to bear, that's our daily problems that we turn over to the Lord in faith and believe in faith that he's got our back, as the song said, God's got it. If you don't believe God's got it and you're over here worrying, guess what, folks? You're in sin. Sin is a worry. Worry is a sin, rather, excuse me. Worry is a sin, and that is what it's, you know, the enemy wants you to get so involved in it, consumed in it, because you're, like, walking downtown New York City, never been there, but I've been to Orlando and in Houston, where they've got these huge skyscrapers, and you look up at the skyscraper, man, that thing is humongous from the ground. I mean, we're talking maybe 120, 130 stories in some of these buildings. It's massive, some of these buildings, okay? But when we get a godly perspective on our daily problems, knowing that God's got it, that we are taking up our cross and following after Jesus, Jesus has got it all under control. If we totally sold ourselves out to him, totally sold ourselves out, that's what's important. You've got to do that, folks. If you've got born again and you didn't deny yourself and you're just doing your own thing, hey, God wants you to use common sense. You know what common sense is, folks? That means take a shower every day, you know, brush your teeth every day. That's common sense. Look both ways before you cross the road. Don't put your hand on anything that's hot or you'll get burnt. You know what I'm talking about? That's common sense. When we get born again, the Lord Jesus Christ, he has to be the Lord over our life. That means anything that I do out of common sense, other than common sense, anything else, I have to involve him in it if I'm born again, truly born again, as what I just read here in these scriptures. And we're going to go on. But I'm just letting you know that you've got to deny yourself, your self-will. Even as one's daily follower follows another, so does one's cross follow another. The cross is, by the figure of speech, metaphorically taken by the mysteries of this life. We have to just know that God's got all this stuff. People's wanting to know when the rapture's going to happen. Well, folks, I'm not going to get in it, but that ain't going to happen. It doesn't work that way. You read the scriptures. Some people are going to throw hate mail. I don't care. I'm just telling you what the Word of God says. We're going to go through some stuff, and when it's time, it's time. Other than that, you need to be about the Father's business doing, carrying your cross, going out here, and the miseries of this life, and the mysteries of this life as well could be miseries as well. But the miseries is the stuff that we're going through our problems. That's what I'm talking about. We must accustom ourselves to all incidents of self-denial. Let me read this again. It says, "For we must accustom ourselves to all instances of self-denial and patience." Oh, you mean if I deny myself, I have to self-denial and put others before me? How dare that? I cannot have that. Sister Bucketmouth at church needs to shut up and sit down. I'm somebody. She's not. I'm just saying this as what people say in the church. Because these people aren't bearing good fruit. They're not bearing patience. They're not bearing fruit of self-denial. I'd rather be cleaning the toilets and being knowing what God wants me to do and over there cleaning the toilets. That means I'm in God's perfect will because I'm submitting to doing janitorial work or whatever it may be, the lowest form. You know, a pastor, an evangelist, we're supposed to be servants unto the people. That means we have to be self-denial and have patience with these folks. I know some pastors and fivefold ministers that snap at like a twig at some situations. That is not of God. Are they really saved? Come on, folks. Just because you say accept Jesus into your heart, that's not what I just read in 9:23. There's more to it. They're not telling you the whole enchilada. They're not telling you the whole story behind it all. You've got to deny yourself. I see so many people. Why do you think this nation is so messed up? Because over so many years, the lie has been preached over the pulpit, over the airwaves, over Bible studies that people don't want to get in and find out really what it's all going to be about, what the Word of God has to say. They want to put their 10 cents in. God says you don't add to the Word or take away anything out of the Word. You just tell it like it is. What I did in 9:23, I just told it like it is. You see what I'm talking, folks? It says we must live a life of self-denial and contentment of this world. Be content in the things of this world. Don't be greedy. I see so many Christians that are going out. They're charging up their charge cards. They're doing this. They want to live the big dream here. Hey, who don't want to live the big dream? But if God isn't in it, I don't want anything to do with it. You hear what I'm saying, folks? I don't want nothing to do. If God isn't in it, I don't want nothing to do with it, because that means there's self-involved. There's hidden agendas. Because if you haven't denied yourself and not picking up your cross and following him after him, then you've got a lot of hidden agendas. You're making wrong choices because of your hidden agendas, folks. We must not indulge or ease an appetite of the things of this world. That's what I'm talking about. People are going, that claim to be a Christian, going about just going hog wilds of the things of this world. You step in and you'd be amazed at the things that you see when the Holy Ghost reveals it to you. For then it will be hard to bear toil and weariness and want for Christ. If you're not denying yourself, you can't be in weariness time and intercession for people and wanting things for the kingdom of God. Come on. What are we doing here in America? This is the reason why judgment is started already here in this nation. Do you want this? Do you want this judgment to turn? It can. I'm going to get to that maybe later on or at another date of time. But it can be done if people deny themselves. It says we are daily subject to affliction, and we must accommodate ourselves to it. It says we are daily subject to afflictions, and we must accommodate ourselves to it, and acquaint in all the will of God in it. Must learn to endure hardship. As the word says in Timothy, endure hardship as a good soldier. Are you out here enduring hardship as a good soldier? Or are you belly aching and complaining because stuff is going on? Oh, why the devil did this? Why did the devil do this? It's all about the devil. No, maybe God is allowing, like he did with Job, allowing you to go through the fiery furnace to see where your faith is being tried, folks. Are you out here belly aching every time you go through something, or are you praising him through it? I'm praising him through it. I'm embracing it. I'm not trying to go around it. I'm not trying to figure out how to get around it. I'm going to have to go through it, because if I don't go through it and endure hardship as a good soldier does, then guess what? 6 days, 6 months, or 6 years, I'll face it again, or we'll face the same thing again if we don't do it right. That means denying yourself and taking up your cross daily. Not just one time. It's every day we've got to do this, folks. We've got to do this. It's so important. It says Christians follow their Lord by imitating his life and obeying his commands. I'll read that again. Christians follow their Lord by imitating his life and obeying his commands. His commands is what the Word of God has to say, folks. And imitating his life is by what the Word of God. Are you spending time in the Word of God so you can't imitate his life and obey his commandments? Because if you're not, then you're still in self-will. You've not died completely, folks. You might have to go on the backside of the desert and die and let the Lord strip you down buck naked in the spirit realm and rebuild you and impartate things and gifts and callings into your lives. But the only way you're going to be able to do that is through denial. It says we must deny ourselves desires. Here's another one. We must deny ourselves desires to use our time. I gotta read that again, folks. I'm gonna slow down a little bit. This one here is gonna really rock your socks. It says we must deny our selfish desires to use our time. And here's the one that's gonna hurt. And money our own way, and to choose our own direction in life without regards to Christ. Oh, man, I'm telling you, that's good. I'm going to read it again for the third time, and I'm going to move on. Because the Holy Ghost is saying to me that you've got to hear this again. We, the people that is denied, we must deny our selfish desires, that's the flesh, to use our time and money our own way, and to choose our own directions in life without regard to Christ. That means doing it my way. Like old Burger King, you know, you have your burger your way. No, it's do it my way. I'm not going to hit the highway. You know, come on, folks. I'm not a singer, but, you know, I'm telling you folks right now, are you doing that? Are you denying your selfish desires to use your time? Your time. Oh, I, well, Evangelist Mike, I work 40 hours a week. I did stuff and I do it at home. Well, that's great. That's great. But during that period of time, why do you think you're at work to begin with? It's not to make money. That's just a benefit of being there. That's not the reason why God has put you there. Maybe you put yourself there. But if God puts you there in that job, guess what? It's for you to be a disciple amongst the people and start laying hands on them, praying for people. And you got to do it discreetly so you don't get fired. But you can do mighty works and exploits for the Lord Jesus Christ at the workplace. But I don't want to do it because I might lose my 20-hour, an hour job that pays 80 hours a week. Now, go do the math. I don't want to lose that money. Well, what about, you know, it says time and money our own way. When you get your paycheck, what do? You just go out there, you pay your bills, which we do. We got to do that. But that money that's left over, do you just go do your thing? Are you putting that money into ministries that are truly serving the kingdom of God and pushing forward for the things of God? That's what it's talking about here, is sowing into fertile ground, fertile ministries, because whatever souls that they reach, you get the credit too, because you did it without grudge. You did it willfully. Did you been paying your tithes? Have you been giving out that money that is supposed to help people? What about your next door neighbor that don't have no food? You know, there's people next door to you that don't have food, or in your neighborhood that don't have food. Are you listening to the Holy Ghost that he's telling you to go over there and giving them some non-perishable food? Come on. There's people out here like this. I know this for a fact, but there is folks out here. Are you doing it? Are you going out there and putting it on their doorstep? You don't have to say, knock on the door. Hey, here's $500 worth of non-perishable food from the whoever's, you know, the Whistlebridge family. You know, well, big deal. That's gloating. No, you take those bags of them non-perishable foods and you just go set it on the front porch and you leave. Let God take care of the rest. That means God's got it, folks. God's got it. You start using your money his way, what he tells you to do, you will be a rich. That's where the prosperity gospel is at, so to speak. You do it God's way, he's going to promote you in finances. You be obedient to what he tells you to do. You know, God is like a beacon, like a radio station. He's always talking. Things are always going out forth. But are you willing to listen? Are you willing to make that choice to listen? And are you willing to make that choice to obey what you hear the Holy Ghost telling you to do? Okay, we're moving on. We got a lot to cover here. It says, follow Christ in this life may be costly. And that's true. Like I said, you might lose your job. But if you do lose your job and you've been witnessing in the break room off on your time, not on the company's time, and you get laid off, hey, guess what? God's got a better job. He's going to put you somewhere else. Do you go to Walmart or Dillon's or wherever you shop at, Piggly Wiggly or a Stick in the Mud store or whatever that's out there? Do you go to there for what? To get food? Well, that should be your last concern. Your first concern is, who do you want me to talk to here in this grocery store or at the gas station or convenience store? They don't have the gas stations now. It's convenience stores. You know, are you going ahead? Are you doing that? Or are you just getting in there, get your stuff, and get out? That's not what Jesus would have done. Let's move on. It says, follow Christ in this life may be costly, but in the long run, it is well worth the pain and effort, because that's obedience. Obedience is better than sacrifice. Obedience will promote you into the kingdom of God. And forget the kudos from everybody else. All I want to do is please my Heavenly Father and be obedient to what he's calling me to do. Here it says, people are willing to pay a high price for something they value. Hello, if you really value the Lord Jesus Christ, why don't you sow into that kingdom, be a king with your money, like I was saying earlier? I'm not harping on money. Sow into these ministries, and I'm not going to give any out. The Holy Ghost will tell you what to give out, because you'll say, well, he's trying to get us to do blah, 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 blah. No, I'm not doing that. I'm going to let the Holy Ghost tell you who to sow into, and we're moving on. It is a surprise that Jesus would demand this much commitment from his followers. Wonder why he wants to do that for, folks. A commitment from his followers. He don't want a ragtag team. He wants a tight, right, and a team, the kingdom of God, where we're all in unity and we're all moving forward. We're not bickering about the color of the carpet of the chairs, of the pews or whatever, or the carpet in the church, or the paint is the wrong color, it stinks, I don't like it, and you bellyache, whine. Hey, God doesn't want that, folks. It's not following Christ. That's not denying yourself. That's you still got flesh in you when you do that. You've got to die daily, it says. Die daily to the flesh. Talks about that in Romans. Dying daily. It says there are at least three conditions that must be met by people who want to follow Jesus. Okay, here we go. We must be willing to deny ourselves, to shoulder our cross, to follow him, and anything else is superficial lip service. Oh, Mike, Evangelist Mike, you said that? Yeah, I'll say it again. We must be willing to deny ourselves, to surrender our cross, shoulder our cross, to shoulder our cross, and to follow him, and anything else is superficial lip service. You're a squawk box. All you do is yank, 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 but there's nothing that you're not doing for Jesus. You're sitting around at the campfire, eating potato chips, eating s'mores, drinking hot chocolate, and watching the stars and everything else go about you in life. Come on. That's not what we're supposed to be doing if we're true disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ. We're going to go on. That was enough for 23. We're going to go on to 24. It says right here, Luke 9:24, for whosoever will save his life shall lose it, but whosoever will lose his life for my sake, the same shall save it. And it goes on to 25. For what is a man an advantage if he has gained the whole world and lost himself, or be cast away into the... You know what he's talking about is going to hell, folks. Because I'm telling you, you serve your self-will. You don't lose your life, your self-will life. You're a Satanist. I'm going to tell you that point blank. If you're not serving Jesus Christ and being obedient, and you're doing your self-will thing, because there's Christians that say they're Christians and they're out here drinking, they're out here carousing around with an adultery, there's ministers that are in fornication, they're out doing all this stuff, and that is not denying yourself. That is appeasing your flesh. When you've got watching pornography, because your sexual desire is being, that's your flesh, folks. The works of the flesh in Galatians 5. Okay? In this present life, we must, important to you, you will do everything you can to protect it. You will not want to do anything that might endanger your safety, health, or comfort. You want the comfort zone. I want to do what I want to do because it's going to keep me out of harm's way. Well, guess what? If you're wholeheartedly doing like we've been saying here, if you're denying yourself and you're carrying your cross daily and you're following after the Lord Jesus Christ, guess what? God's got it. He's got your back through Christ Jesus, because he is watching out after you. Says, by contrast, in following Jesus is most important. You may find yourself in unsafe, unhealthy, and uncomfortable places. Isn't that right, folks, that are out here serving the Lord? The Lord puts you there. You shouldn't be in fear. You shouldn't be in fear whatsoever. I want to go into the ghettos. I want to go into the where the gangbangers are at. I want to get down in there right behind enemy lines. I want to get down into the trenches. I want to get in there and start witnessing to the Lord Jesus Christ. I've been doing it, but I want to go in there like at Clarksdale, Mississippi, and some other places that are on the agenda, and start getting in there and just start witnessing to people about Jesus. Well, you know, what are we, a squawk box here? This isn't squawk box radio. No, this is consuming fire radio here, folks. You know, consuming fire radio, we want to get in as a whole and get in to where the action is. Get in and start meeting these people's needs spiritually. Ask them, are you hurting? Where are you hurting at? Are you sick? Let me lay hands on you. When you lay hands on these people, they get delivered and set free from these demonic oppressions. Then you can minister the Lord Jesus Christ to them, and they will become to the Lord. But until then, you're a squawk box. You're doing nothing. You're going about it the wrong way. You've got to meet their needs, and it's spiritually, because these people that are out here in the ghettos, they're out here where the gangbangers and the drug dealers and everywhere else is at, they're hurting, folks, because you know why? I'm going to tell you that for a fact. I used to be that way because I used to be a drug addict and alcoholic for 21 years. Most people don't know this, but I'm going to tell you anyway. But, you know, and shame on Christendom, because the Christians weren't doing their job, because nobody for 21 years came and ministered Jesus Christ to me. Nobody came up to me and said, sir, you can be delivered from that drugs and alcohol if you want. And the lifestyle, see, they never give me that choice. I only knew one choice, one way is what I've been doing, until I got to the end and said, I am done living in this hogwash of a way of life. There's got to be a better way. I checked myself into a treatment center, and that's where the Lord Jesus Christ met me at. And I got born again the first night in that treatment center. And that's I've been on fire ever since, because all I did was change masters. I just changed masters from serving self and Satan and all the other things that go with it to wholly on fire for the Lord Jesus Christ. Glory to God. I just get excited when knowing that if he can do it for me, he can do it for these other people that are out here hurting. But guess what? He's got to have some disciples that have come to the Lord Jesus Christ by first denying their self and picking up their cross daily and following after the Lord Jesus Christ, following him. And then you can have the power. You can get in there and start fighting in the trenches. People don't know this. This is the reason why they're sitting in the bleachers at the game. They're just sitting there. The players are out there playing on the football field, but you got the audience. And I don't want to be in the audience. I want to be out on the football field with God playing, getting out there, not playing, but getting out there into the trenches and getting in there and being a doer of the word of God. Now, this next verse, I'm going to hit on hard on this, folks. We're going to get into it here in just a minute. But I've got some other stuff. It says, we may risk death, but you will not fear, because you know that Jesus will raise you into eternal life. Do you know, folks, and I'll say this, and I'll expound on this. I had a heart valve that went out on me in February. I was on the shower room floor at the YMCA. I thought I was going to die, and Lord spoke to my heart, the Holy Ghost did, and he said, son, you're going to live, and you're not going to die. I've got a mighty work for you to do, and this is what I want you to do. And he said, and he gave me step by step what was going to happen. And do you know, folks, what he told me? It all worked out that way. And now I'm regaining my strength physically and spiritually back in him. And it's awesome because, you know, there wasn't that last breath. You know, you hear a lot of ministers, oh, well, they're going to have that last breath. They'll call out to Jesus to come into their life. Well, guess what? When I was on that shower room floor gasping for air, guess what was running through my mind? I'm dead. I'm dying. It didn't say, well, maybe I can ask the Lord now to see if I can get into heaven. That didn't even run across my mind, even though that I was already saved. Come on, folks. It doesn't work that way. When you're dying, you're in fear. I wasn't, but the world, when they are, they're in fear because they don't know where they're going. Now, that they're going to hell if they don't know Jesus Christ. Same way with these so-called Christians that are not doing their sin of iniquity in their lives. That means sin of iniquity means they know it's wrong to do it. They know it's wrong to fornicate. They know it's wrong to do this and do that sin and do this sin and smoke a little bit of dope and drink a little bit of alcohol. You can do it all in moderation. That's a lie from the pits of hell, folks. That's a license to sin. That doctrine's a license to sin, and I don't care who says what. That's a license to sin. You don't do that stuff. You're walking a holy lifestyle before the Lord? Because when you walk a holy lifestyle, that means you're denying yourself will, Mike Bradford's will. That means I've dethroned God and put myself on there when I'm in my self-will. That means I'm a Satanist, because anybody that serves self is serving the devil. So you're basically a Satanist, folks, when you're in self-will. It says, Jesus' disciples are not to use their lives on earth for their own pleasure. Uh-oh. Where'd that come from? I read it again. Jesus' disciples, plural, meaning more than one, are not to use their lives on earth for their own pleasure. Yeah, God wants you to have good things. He wants you to have to be pleasurable and everything else. But that's not the center of your life. Hello? Because the Lord spoke to me, said, these people that say they're Christians and they're gaining all these riches here upon this earth, they're getting their own reward right now. I don't want that. I want to have my reward when I get to heaven. I want to be a worker into the field of the kingdom of God, out here in the hedges and the byways and the trenches, fighting a good fight of faith, as the word says, enduring hardship as a good soldier. In other words, carrying on, soldier. You know, keep the fight going. Now, what are we doing? Are we laying all of our weapons down? You know what our weapons are? Is our testimonies. I don't hear any testimonies anymore. I hear a lot of testifonies going on, but not testimonies. I'd like to hear a testimony. You know what God's done in your life today. You know, here it is, the 23rd of September. I want to hear on phone line somebody today that has had something happen that the Lord Jesus Christ has done in their life. And guess what? I've gave out the phone line number and nobody wants to call in. This is live going over Spreaker. Everybody's sitting back just listening. Come on, folks, I'm challenging you. I want to hear what God is doing in your life. A testimony, that is our weapon against the enemy. Saying, here, devil, take this. My God is my Jehovah Jireh. He has and is and will supply all my needs through the glory of Christ Jesus. He's doing it right now, today, on the 23rd of September. Hallelujah. I tell you, people need to start praising God and stop praising the things of this world. You go to a church service. When I was going to church, you go to a men's meeting, and I thought we were really going to get into some meat of some word. And guess what? It was football season, and all I heard about, hey, how about that St. Louis Cardinals? Aren't they doing great? How about that quarterback? Isn't he doing great? I'm thinking, what does that have to do with anything about coming here today of us having a men's meeting and discussing Jesus Christ? All I heard is about things going on in the world. I don't care what's going on in the world, folks. I you know, don't get me wrong. I love to watch a hockey game, a baseball game, and a motocross and some other, you know, NASCAR stuff. But that doesn't take my time. Yes, if it's on and I'm passing by, I might stand there and look at it for a little bit, you know, while somebody's watching it in my house. But I'm not going to sit there and Google eye over it and sit there glued like I used to, because the Lord has stripped me of that, because I want to serve Him. I don't want to serve this stinking world that we live in. The only reason that we are here upon this earth are supposed to be ambassadors for Christ. And you know what an ambassador is? Hello, it's supposed to be a representation of where they come from, what country they're coming from. Like an ambassador, the U.S. ambassador, and he goes into Iraq or, you know, France or wherever, he's representing the U.S. of A. Well, here I'm supposed to be representing the kingdom of God, and you guys are supposed to be out here representing the kingdom of God. Who are you representing? You know, are you representing your self-will to people? Do they want to change because they're seeing you doing the same thing? And Fred goes, here's Sinner Fred. And if you're out here and your name's Fred, forgive me, but I'm just using this as an example. Look at that guy, Joe. He's supposed to be a Christian. He's the deacon of the church. Look what he's doing over here. He's over here doing this, doing that, doing this, doing that. Folks, this goes on all the time. I hear it. You're not living a holy lifestyle before God. We're moving on to the next scripture. This next scripture, folks, the Lord's going to do some spanking. It says here, Luke 9:26, is for whosoever shall be ashamed of me and my words, of him shall the Son of Man be ashamed, when he shall come in his own glory and in his Father's and of the holy angels. That means if you don't be going out telling everybody about Jesus, you should be, like they said back in the late 60s, early 70s, Jesus freaks. Man, just talk about Jesus. That's what I am. I'm a Jesus freak. Man, all I want to talk about is Jesus Christ. My life is centered around Jesus Christ. I love Jesus Christ. He is the Lord over my life. He has saved my life. I want to serve him with all my soul, mind, body, and spirit that I can. And yes, I do mess up like the next guy, but I try to live a repentive lifestyle, folks. That is so important when you mess up that you can say, Lord, because, you know, we get bombarded. I'm going to tell you right now, we get bombarded by thoughts. And all these thoughts that hit into our brain that we hear in our brain is not of God. Because you got a devil that's got these little imps, demons, that are out here throwing in these thoughts of lust, you know, of greed, you know, all these other fleshly sins. And if you start entertaining it and thinking on it, you're going to end up and acting out and doing it. Instead of like 2 Corinthians 10:5, I'm just going to paraphrase it. It's, you know, you think on things that are of God. Anything that isn't of God, you kick it to the curb. You don't think on it. I have to speak to my head and say, head, shut up. You will not. You know, that's, I'm speaking to my head because my head is flesh. And I'm thinking, you're going to shut up. You're going to get in line with God's word. And you will come into submission to the Lord Jesus Christ. Because the spirit in me, my spirit man, is more dominant than my fleshly man. This has only come through spending time with the Lord Jesus Christ, denying yourself, and I keep saying it again, and pick up your cross daily and follow after Jesus Christ. You do that, folks, you could not go wrong. But why are you ashamed of Jesus? Because if you were not ashamed of Jesus, everywhere you go, you'd be talking about Jesus Christ. Well, you don't want to be so heavenly minded and you're no earthly good. No, that's a lie from the pits of hell. You show me in the Word of God what that has to say. That's an old wives' tale stuff that tried to put a squelch on people because they were anointed, they were fired up, and these other people weren't, and they tried to quench their spirit, and they did for a lot of them, but not all of them. They're not going to happen to me because I'm a Jesus freak. And I'm going to go out here telling everybody that I come in contact with about Jesus. When I'm working on a site of carpentry, and I was at one place, make a long story short, there was a busy sidewalk, people up and down. So I took a break, about a 10-minute break, and went out there and sat on a curb. Well, it wasn't on a curb. It was like a retaining wall. I sat up there. As people come by, I started sharing Jesus Christ with them. Some people, they ran down the road, down the sidewalk, because those demons in them did not want to hear it. Some people did. And hopefully they made the right choice of decisions. But it has to be a minister. They have to hear it from somebody. They have to hear it out of your lips. How's somebody going to get saved? The only way they're going to get saved is if they have a minister, or we're all called, we are all ministers of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We've all been called to proclaim the word of God to everybody. Don't be ashamed of Jesus Christ, because if you do, like it says here, he's going to be ashamed of you and say, Mike Bradford, I don't know who he is. He don't belong here. Depart from me, I never knew you. You know, Lord says in Revelation, he wants you hot or cold, not lukewarm. One of the two. Because if you're cold, you're out. He wants you hot. He wants you red hot, blue hot, or white hot. I think white hot's the hottest. He wants you white hot for Jesus Christ to pass through the glory of the Holy Ghost in your life. That's the only way, folks. La Ruta Shed. I don't care if anybody says, well, you didn't have nobody to interpret it. Hogwash, you know. I'm just praising my God in the spirit. You know, I don't really care what anybody thinks anymore. Only thing what I care is what the Lord Jesus Christ thinks of me. Glory to God. It says both would be ashamed of Jesus. That means God, too. If they did not look past his death to his glorious resurrection and the second coming. The second coming, it's another story, not getting in it right now, but, you know, that's getting ready to happen. Who knows when? We're going to carry on. We're going to be a good soldier. We're going to get out here and winning souls for the kingdom of God. We're advancing the kingdom. We're advancing the kingdom globally through Consuming Fire Radio, through Gospel Music Explosion, and Word of Flame Radio, and other ministries that are out here. We're marching forward for the kingdom of God. It says then, they would see Jesus not as a loser, but as the Lord of the universe, who through his death brought salvation to all people. And he did bring salvation to all people, but they have to make that choice. The choice has to be brought out of your mouth that I'm speaking to out here. You have to open those lips there that has, you know, behind in front of your teeth. You got to open them lips up and you got to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ, not be ashamed. Well, I can't talk to anybody. I feel very inferior. Well, you need to get delivered and set free from that spirit, because that's what it is. Keep trying to keep you back from going out there and getting fired up for Jesus Christ. This is what he's after. He wants you red hot, white hot. Okay? It says they would see Jesus not as the loser, but as the Lord of the universe, which he is Lord of all. That's what the word says. He's the beginning, the end, the Alpha and Omega. He is everything, the Lord Jesus Christ. Through his death brought salvation to all people. But they've got to hear it so they can come to Christ. And verse 27 says, but I tell you of the truth, there be some standing here that shall not taste of death till they shall see the kingdom of God. And then he was talking to his disciples there. And I'm telling you, folks, when we are his disciples, and we have got to get with the program. It says, when Jesus said some would not die without seeing the kingdom, he was referring to Peter, John, and James, and all the other disciples. They went up to Mount, ones there that I just mentioned, went up to the Mount of Transfiguration for 8 days, you know, and there's others that are here that, you know, they seen death, you know, his disciples, they all seen death in one shape or form. You know, if the second coming of Christ does not happen in our time, then we're going to see death. You know, I thought I was going to see death on the shower room floor of the YMCA, but guess what? God gave me a second chance. He gave me more chances. You know, he said, okay, you're going to go out here and you're going to do what I've called you to do, son. This is so important, folks. We've got to quit playing this childish game of greed. See how much, you know, how big I can make my church, and I'm going to make my church bigger than your church, you know. It's like kids playing with Legos. Now I'm going to build my house bigger than yours with Legos, you know, and they get into a fight, and squabbling and everything else. Well, the same thing's going on because that's childishness. That's nothing but flesh, folks, because they've never died to their stinking flesh. So we've got to come to Christ in a powerful way, folks. We've got to have repentance. There's got to be godly sorrow. What happened to the fear of God? You know, there's nobody hardly that is ministering on the fear of God out of the pulpit anymore because it's, quote, an unpopular message that comes forth because it's not going to bring in the tithe money and the offering money to pay for the lights and all this and that and that and this. Well, let me tell you something, Joe. You know, it's God's church. He said he adds to the church daily, not Joe. If there is a Joe pastor out there, excuse me, just using a name that just come up, you know, that's what I'm doing, just using a name. So come on, folks, let's get with the program and let's sell ourselves out to the Lord Jesus Christ. That's all he's asking. That is all he's asking. I'm going to play one more selection of music and I'll be right back.
What would I do if the Lord took his arms from around me? I'd succumb to the grips of the unknown. But I know I'm not supposed to feel this way. I know that I'm supposed to trust you every day. But it gets so hard to keep it all moving. Sometimes I feel like I'm losing my grip on God.
This conference is being recorded. Your conference recording has stopped.
Bothering me. It's written in your word. You got my needs. But I know I'm not supposed to feel this way. I know that I'm supposed to trust you every day. But it gets so hard to keep it all moving. Sometimes I feel like I'm losing my grip on God. I'm trying to live like my faith ain't strong enough. Oh, yeah. I'm trying to live like my faith ain't strong enough.
Amen and amen. Is your faith strong enough, folks, to see you through the things that are getting ready to happen to this nation and the world, mainly in this nation, if it does not come into repentance? God's judgment will come full force upon this nation. It can get turned around. Believe me, it can get turned around by people repenting of their sin and the people really saying, hey, you know, I'm tired of living this way. I don't want nothing to do with it. I don't want anything to do with this anymore. This is what we've got to do, folks. We've got to get in and we got to repent of our sins as a nation, starting with you and I, and living a holy, repentive lifestyle and a way of holiness. Holiness is a lifestyle, folks. That means doing what the Word of God has to say. And that means denying yourself. If he has to, he'll slap you down. And let me tell you this. If you don't get rid of your self-will, then sin will overtake you. And some of you that I'm talking to out here this evening need serious deliverance before you can get born again. You've got to get delivered and set free before you can have the Holy Ghost and Jesus into your life and God. You can't have an entity that is dwelling in there and expect him to stay in there with the Lord. It don't not work that way. It's no go. It's not going to work that way. And folks, I thank you for showing up here this evening. And all I'm asking is to people that are Christians, really look what you did when you became born again. Are you really denying yourself, your self-will, and are you following after the Lord Jesus Christ? And are you carrying your cross daily? That's all he wants you to do, and be obedient. Till next time, folks, we'll see you again. Love you.
Thank you for listening. This has been a Consuming Fire Radio audio production.